Hi, first off, I'd like to welcome everyone to actually come along to our event this evening. So our event is basically, it's a follow-up event to what we had, I think it was back in February, we had an additive manufacturing event, and we're looking at additive manufacturing. We want to kind of give people the scope of what it's for and what it's doing, but now we want to focus in a little bit more and kind of focus on some of the industrial applications of it and what people are doing and what's really happening, the limitations and the challenges for the future. So we've got a great lineup of speakers. We're going to have Professor Byrne from UCD is going to give us a quick 5-minute introduction just to warm up the event. And then we're going to have Jonathan Downey from Schivo and then Eoin from the Medical Device Design Group as well, followed by Colin Cater from Arcam, from the UK. So, and then we'll have a short break, and then after the break, Emmanuel Reynaud from Biology and UCD is going to give a talk as well, and then we'll have Noel Harrison from NUIG. And then after that, we're going to have an open discussion, so we'll have our speakers up here, and everyone will be able to ask questions and question them and question each other, so that should be fun. I'm going to have, we've quite a few speakers to get through, so we're going to only have maybe one or two questions after each presentation, maybe 15 or 20 minutes slot for each one. So I think I'll start with Professor Byrne.
Oh yeah, good evening, Shane. Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here to as well as open this event and to be present for the discussion on 3D printing. And it's a really interesting question that you pose. Is it all just hype? So interested to hear what the final answer will be later on this evening. So in my own case, I'm Gerry Byrne. I'm a professor of mechanical engineering in UCD. I'm also very actively involved in the Fraunhofer and there's a liaison office that we're established in Dublin or in Ireland, and so I'm representing Fraunhofer in Ireland as well. My own background is totally non-additive. In fact, if you think of the opposite to additive, it's probably subtractive. And I'm a subtractive person, so I've been looking at machining and micro-machining for many years, many decades. So I've looked at it from that side. So it's very interesting to see now how the things have changed as a result of moving, as well as when we didn't have additive manufacturing. I was involved, actually, at one stage in Ireland. We had a project, a joint venture project with Queen's University, where we developed, there was a product design and development centre that we had running in the late 90s, early 2000s, and it was in the area of offering a service to industry on polymeric additive manufacturing. So it was a little bit early for industry at that stage, so it's very interesting to see what has happened in that intervening period. So I suppose in terms of 3D printing, it's after moving on automatically, does it? I suppose you could say almost an unprecedented awareness of 3D printing and of additive manufacturing technologies. That's kind of unusual in the very specific space of mechanical engineering, I think, because we don't normally see that with technologies that we're involved with, at least that I would be aware of. So it's quite nice as well to see that society has taken some level of ownership of the 3D printing scenario. I think the expectations for 3D printing may be a little bit artificial, maybe not quite understanding the complexities in behind particularly the metallic one, and the polymeric one is quite well advanced, but I think there's still a lot of questions, open questions, and we'll hear them tonight on the metallic side. But there is this culture emerging, very high level of interest, and we're seeing it all around us, so that's, as I said, is unusual. There's large levels of investment needed in this space, I suppose I come from the technical system of machine tool area, which was subtractive, five-axis type of work, so I can see a translation in the development of the machines from what we have in the subtractive into the additive. So at the end of the day, we need very high positional accuracies. We probably need very high speed as well, but we do need very high speed. We need the stiffness of the system to be high. In the machine tool area, we look at the thermal features of the machine and the thermal distortions to get the accuracy. And we also look at the dynamic behaviour. So the loading would be different. There'd be probably different thermal to mechanical loading to a machine tool. But it's interesting to compare with the conventional systems. I think I can see with the development of some of the technical systems that is moving in the direction. There's some parallels to what happened with the subtractive machine tool sector. So that's. But there is large investment of technical system, but then also the people. I think in the training and the education side, there's huge areas that need to be addressed. I think when we go deeper into the polymeric and out of the metallic space, and the training of the people, I suppose there's a question in my mind. As former Dean of Engineering in UCD, so are we really training our engineers now to meet the requirements for what the systems, what are required of the systems? And in my opinion, 3D printing and additive, it's very different in design terms. We need now, the capability that we have is opened up, it's quite different. So what we could do, when we're designing in the past, I often would say to students, there's no point in coming with a design unless you can make it. But now the opportunities to make are very different and have opened right up. So the constraints that we had in the past are very different to what we will have in the future, indeed what we currently have. There are, however, in the application space, I think tonight, I'm not going to dwell on that there now, but we will see many, I think this is on an automatic thing, isn't it? It's great. I think that was what you expected I'd speak at that speed. So there's, I won't dwell on the application areas, but there are really exciting areas in there. Again, I think, is it all just hype? Well, I think we are getting to areas where it's very, very serious. It's not all just hype. And it does change the way we can manufacture and offers very, very good opportunities. There are limitations and challenges, and some of the challenges, I think, lie in the validation aspect. I don't think we've addressed yet the cost issue, and I think the economics, there will be applications which will be very suited and be economical, but there'll be applications that are not, and other methods will be better. So I think there'll be work to do both in the technical and in the economic side. That links back into the achievable cycle times. The achievable surface finish and the quality, but not just that, but also the dimensional tolerance capability. So those issues offer challenges. And isn't that fantastic for us then as engineers, those of us that are engineers, that we have that opportunity to develop a new technology and then that opens up and then that society already appreciates. That's not often the case that the society appreciates. What I would say I think that's critical in this space is that we're aware of the international standards that are being developed, and then also that we take a proactive involvement in the development of those standards. That's what I would suggest we watch. And then just to acknowledge the Engineers Ireland and the IMechE has a long-standing tradition here in this building, in fact, and the work that the senior committee does, I don't think it calls itself senior, but the work that the senior committee does is absolutely fantastic. There's really, really good work going on in lectures and dissemination of information and so on. And now I'm particularly pleased, maybe as being the oldest person in the audience, to be at the young members section and to be opening this. And I'm very pleased to see that the young engineers are taking such an active role here. There was a very good event organised last year in Additive, so this is kind of building, I think, on that event. The young engineers recognising the professional body and working with the professional bodies to develop and support and develop their own professional body is a very important thing. So for young engineers, and I gave a lecture to the second years in UCD there this morning, it's really it's fascinating for them to see how this technology is developing. I spoke to them about it and the opportunities that they have now going forward. So the constraints that we were faced with are not there through this new technology. So my answer at the moment, and I'd be interested to see whether it changes during the course of the evening, but my answer is no, it is not hype. It's a very, very serious opportunity for us in Ireland. I think it will change many things, including the supply chain. It will offer opportunity for regional development. So in regions in Europe and in Ireland, that are not necessarily very highly populated with companies. There's regional development potential coming through this. I think the supply chain could fundamentally change actually through 3D printing and through additive manufacturing. So there are great opportunities also for the young engineers. So Shane, thank you for the invitation to speak, and I hope you have a really great evening and a good stimulating discussion at the end of it. So thank you.
I'd like to thank Professor Byrne for his presentation, and Jonathan will now be up, so just load it up here. Okay. So I'll just make a ding maybe around 18 minutes or something.
I'll get back to the start of that. Good evening, everyone. Shane asked me to talk here at this event this evening. I kind of wasn't sure what exactly I was going to say, because when I look at some of the other speakers, there's a real expertise in the whole area of 3D printing that I don't intend to add a huge amount to, but what I would like to do is give you, from an industrial perspective, our experience as a company implementing additive manufacturing in a traditional CNC machine shop, which we started about 18 months ago. The company, and only very quickly, just to give you an idea of who we are, we're a precision engineering subcontract manufacturer. We principally are engaged in CNC machining and traditional subtractive manufacturing. We do quite a bit of assembly work. We do a lot of high precision work for companies like Stryker, Waters, and big multinationals. We're based in Waterford, principally headquartered in Waterford, but we have a site in the UK, and about 2 months ago we bought a site up in Derry, a company called Maydown Engineering. So our biggest markets are medical device and aerospace. We've got certifications, as you can see there, to the Norman 9001, ISO 13485, which is the medical device standard, and AS9100. We're approved supplier into Rolls-Royce, Airbus and Bombardier. In terms of our 3D printing capability, we've formed a partnership with Stratasys, and we're their business partner for polymer in Ireland and the UK. We've got three Stratasys polymer machines on the ground that were installed in February of this year. So there's two Fortis 400 machines and a Fortis 900. They're all production grade machines, and our target is to put 20 machines on the ground in Waterford in the next 2 years. That's not just a target we pulled out of the air. We've got a couple of contracts with fairly major companies that will kind of drive us in that direction. We've also started a partnership with Boston Scientific and WIT, where we've put an EOS M280 direct metal laser sintering printer into one of the research centres in the college. We're printing actively in metal on that, in titanium, stainless steel, and maraging steel. That's an example of the two printers we've got. The one on the left is a Fortis 900. That's on the ground. That's just outside my office, actually, in the factory in Waterford. The one on the right is the EOS M280. That's in WIT. Both those machines are kind of in excess of $500,000 in value, so they're fairly serious production-grade machines. This is an example. Jerry was talking about subtractive manufacturing earlier on. This is an example of one of the machines that we've always had and that we've always made parts out of on this machine. So that's a CNC lathe. I'm sure everybody in the room recognises what that is. And you'll all know that process is, start with a blanking material, you're removing material, you turn it down to a different size blank, then you're into five-axis machining, and that's the resulting product that we make. Very, very subtractive, very time-consuming, but very, very accurate and very, very repeatable. Our Fortis machines are based around fused deposition modelling, which is where the material is fed up through the spool into the print head, and you get wonderful part geometries with that particular type of 3D printing. So all the polymer machines use that technique. And as I said, look, you can see the build material in there, and the resulting part is quite a unique geometry. And I get to geometries shortly, because I do agree with something Jerry was saying there a minute ago. So our metal sinter printer uses a powder bed, and it basically welds the powder to the shape layer by layer of the part. So you've got powder pushed up, a recoder arm pushes the powder over, it sinters it layer by layer, and you can get wonderful part geometries that, and again I get to this, that are kind of unattainable through normal production methods. One of the things that people are being critical about direct metal laser sintering at the moment is the cost of producing the part. But by producing, this is an aircraft part, and it's it's an example of a part everybody shows, but you can see the amount of material reduction as a result of metal printing, so it's much lighter. So what the printing companies, what the metal printing companies are saying is, although it's costlier to produce the part in terms of the energy requirements, over the long-term use of the part, for example, just as a part in an aircraft, it will save you money in energy costs. One of the things that we've learned about additive manufacturing is, with the exception, take the metal out of the way for the moment, but with the plastic parts, the operation of the printer is simple. It's absolutely, we've got very, very expensive printers, and it is as simple as click and print and sending it to the printer. So this is an existing part that we're making on a CNC machine. Just by importing the model that we had already, we were able to print that in about an hour and a half. So it goes from the virtual model to physical component in just the build time. And that's one of the killer apps of additive, is the fact that you don't have programming, you don't have setups, you don't have all that stuff that you've got to do in subtractive manufacturing. You can just bring the model in and print it. I kind of thought about what the real advantages and disadvantages of subtractive versus additive are. As I said, we've got both, so we know what the good and the bad about each of them is. Subtractive, the advantages is it's proven technology. It's around for years. It's extremely accurate, and 3D printing is not as accurate as CNC machining at the moment. It's very cost effective. The advantages of additive is obviously rapid prototype, and that's what it's been used for years. We're doing some work for a medical device company at the moment, and they make a device that uses a plastic housing. For their clinical trials, they need to make 120 units, and they're used to validate the design. It can take up to 5 months for them to get samples. We printed enough samples for them to do a clinical trial in 10 days, and we were only learning on the machine at the time. So speed is one of the big sellers. The design constraints, and this is, I think, one of the biggest untapped areas of this technology, is the fact that you're unconstrained by traditional manufacturing methods. Jerry, you said, an engineer comes into you with a design and you say, well, you have to be able to make it. And I've seen that happen as well. And where a CNC machine, there's a brilliant design, but from a tool path point of view, it's unmanufacturable. You don't have that constraint with this technology. And as I mentioned, it can be learned really, really quickly. The disadvantages of subtractive are the long setup times, programming, the level of programming that can be required for each component. And there is a high level of skill involved in subtractive manufacturing. Our experience has been that with a low batch job shop, which our CNC machine shop tends to be, high value, low batches, we have highly skilled people working the machines. There's very few people that, you can set it up and leave them off to push a button. The disadvantage in the additive, it is less accurate. The surface finish is not as good in additive manufacturing, with the exception maybe of stereolithography, but a CNC machine surface finish is far superior to anything I've seen so far coming from a 3D printed machine. The mechanical characteristics are another concern that, for example, the aerospace industry. I sat in front of a guy working for one of the big aero engine manufacturers, and he asked me, how can you guarantee that every single layer in that part is fused perfectly? And I answered by asking him, how can you guarantee that an extruded part has no flaws in the material? And his answer was, it's proven, and that's the way we've made it for so long. 3D is not yet proven in terms of the mechanical characteristics. We are doing some work, because we need to be able to sell this to the aerospace boys. So we are doing some work proving out the process and validating the process. And in doing that, some of the things that we're looking at, and this is in tandem with the college, but things like microstructural finish, surface finish assessment, the chemical composition, crystallographic information, because when we go to an aerospace manufacturer, we have to be able to hand them a pack that demonstrates that this part is absolutely bulletproof. So for a company like us, we certainly wouldn't have access to this type of equipment, but this is the type of equipment that we're using on a subcontract basis to verify each of those different characteristics of the material. We have the coordinate measuring machines ourselves, but everything else is subcontracted. So we're using something like X-ray type microtomography to do a 3D CAT scan of a part to be able to demonstrate that for a given material, for a given set of settings, this is the resultant part, and that part is every bit as good as an extruded and machined component. The other thing that we've learned is that for the world we live in, just buying a 3D printer and click and print is not enough. We have to be able to post-process the parts, more than just verifying. We'll only verify parts once. We'll tease out process parameters, and once we've learned that, we'll know that. But you need CNC capability, or at least for the world we live in, we need CNC capability for a lot of the parts that we supply to, for example, medical device customers. And a simply printed part, thus far in our experience, is not enough. We need to get a higher level of accuracy than a CNC machine will give. But there's also there's deburring, removal of burrs, cleaning, coating, painting, non-destructive testing, grinding. All those elements are all an integral part of our process. So as I said, it's not just the case that we wheeled in a couple of 3D printers, click print and off you go. What we've learned so far is that the technology is not quite to the level that we need it to be. And not by accident, we've got a Morisiki NMV 1500. Not by accident, Morisiki have identified this as well, and they've developed this machine, which is what they're calling the hybrid machine. It's the 3D printer on one side, transfers the 3D printed component into the CNC machine. You can do some CNC machining, transfer it back. So Morisiki, Mazak, all these guys have identified that at the moment a hybrid system might be the best thing for real precision engineering. Is it all hype? When I looked at this, it was at a conference 2 years ago in 2013, and this was where 3D printing was, enterprise 3D printing, what we do. It was right here, but what kind of caught my eye really was the 3D scanners were way back here, and there's 3D bioprinting and consumer 3D printing there as well. But if you fast forward to last year, and I know I'm 12 months out of date, July 2014, but the point I'm making is that, enterprise 3D printing has come along a little bit, and it's almost ready for kind of general release, I think. 3D scanners have come right the way around, so I think there's going to be a lot of work or a lot of learning done, and we've already looked at 3D scanners. Right now, we don't think we're ready for 3D scanning, because we live in a world of 3D models anyway. But, you know, asking the question, is it hype? You can see there that it's moving along the hype cycle very, very quickly. One of the challenges we've found, when I put the printers in, we've about 140 people working on the floor in Waterford, and several people said to me, CNC machine has said, those things are going to take our jobs. And I'm saying to them, lads, there's no comparison, and we can't be looking at current parts, the accuracy level that we need on current parts, and putting them onto 3D printers. But I gave one of the guys, this is a CNC machine part that we make for an instrumentation customer. I gave him this and I asked him to convert this to a 3D printed design. And what he came back to me initially was, that shape just 3D printed. And I said, no, look, to Jerry's point, the geometries that these things can produce, I think that's the untapped thing. The geometries that these things can produce, traditional engineers don't think like that. They think about how they subtract material from a block. Whereas with these, and I'll show you what we eventually came up with by redesigning this is essentially a manifold for a mass spectrometer. So we had a look at what exactly it is, had a look at exactly what we needed it to do. Then we removed what we were calling conventional machine constraints. So that's the 3D model of what that part was going to look like from a 3D printer. And that's it metal printed. Now I know it's a little bit ugly, it's not as shiny as the CNC machine part, but that's not the point. The point is, if you wanted to make that any other way, you'd either make it in multiple parts or you'd make it with a hammer and a chisel by hand, because you couldn't machine CNC. Well, you could CNC machine it, but it'd take you weeks. But then, to my point about all the post-processing stuff, the supports around those connecting pipes there. So you need to take the support off. We then learned that we're still going to have to CNC machine it, because there's an injection nozzle port there for an ion stream, and that's not accurate enough. We need to machine the features on the front face, because we've got to put supports in there. You can see there's a port there. You can't print that port. You've got to put a support in there. So we have to go in with the drill anyway. So to do what we do, we can't do it on a 3D printer. This part, you've probably all seen this. This is a heat exchanger that EOS built. I mean, that's a geometry that, sure, you'll machine it, but I mean, it's going to be so expensive to machine that. It's just prohibitive. You wouldn't bother. But a heat exchanger like that, it's ideal. You're increasing surface area, and it's tremendously complex, but not on a 3D printer. The complexity is in the design and in the model. Once you've done that, the printer doesn't see that as a 3D object. It sees it as hundreds of 2D layers. Somebody described it to me as 2D printing over and over again. And that's essentially what it is. It prints a layer, and it goes back, and it prints the next layer, and it doesn't care what the previous layer was. Molds for injection molding, I think, are another big... These are not the kind of sexy stuff that everybody's, you know, looking at, bespoke implants and that type of thing, but this is the bread and butter technology that can be improved. I was in a university in the UK, I think it was Wolverhampton, sorry, and they've had 3D printers, metal 3D printers on the ground there for 10 years. They printed a part for a McLaren Formula One car, and it was a multi-ported manifold. And when you saw what they printed compared to the block and all the machining that went into it, it really kind of would open your eyes as to, you know, all bets are off in terms of design constraints on parts. There's a lot of people thinking outside the box, pardon the pun or whatever, but the lads in China have printed houses. They printed, I think it was 20 houses in, 10 houses, beg your pardon, in something like 24 hours. And essentially all it is, it's an XY concrete pouring machine. So it's a little bit of a, it's a little bit Irish to call it a little bit Chinese to call it a 3D printer. But that's essentially what it is. It's moving in XY, it's printing in XY, and it's moving in Z when each layer is done. Our printers, the build plate move in Z, but in this case, the extrusion head, which is essentially what it is moving in Z. They're printing chocolate. And again, it's the same thing. It's just injecting chocolate through an XYZ stage. This is probably a long way away from being done, although there has been an implanted 3D printed bowel in a woman in the US somewhere had a bowel implanted. But I see recently, over the last 2 or 3 years, the MIT have a self-assembly lab. And when you first look at it, it looks almost kind of crazy what they're trying to do, or a little bit kind of out there. They're printing stresses into 3D printed parts that will self-assemble. That's the MIT logo, but you can see that the string across the top is what they 3D printed with stresses in it, and it pulls together. I saw a demonstration, a guy called Skylar Tibbetts, I think his name is leading this, and he had a rod and he threw it up in the air to form the shape of a protein. So, I mean, if you think about, right, well, what's the application there? It looks lovely. He stands up on stage, throws it up in the air, but who knows that, you know, you can't 3D print collagen gag scaffolding for keyhole surgery. That, you know, that's possibly an application of what they're doing there. How can it be capitalised by industry? And I'll sum up now. It's faster implementation of new designs, obviously. Concepts and geometries. I met with some of the people in WIT recently, and we were talking about this, and, you know, one of them asked me, will we put a 3D printing module on the manufacturing engineering degree? And I said, well, don't just put an explanatory module showing people how the 3D printers work. Show them what they can do and get people thinking in new ways, not just, you know, as I said earlier, not just taking a block of material, shaping it, and what the resulting part is. Like, I sometimes think the, you know, software designers and people that do, I don't know, the Minecraft, that type of thinking is probably better than a mechanical engineer in some regards, because you don't, once you prove out the process, you don't really need to understand the mechanics, because it does the same thing every single time. Now, I should kind of caveat that with a health warning. We're seeing a massive learning curve for us on the metal printing, because the stress relieving, we have to heat treat it, and we're not, I mean, as I said to Tony during the week, I don't think we're at a production ready stage on those machines just yet. We'll get there fast, but there's a bit more mechanical and chemical science, chemical structural, etc. understanding that's needed in the metal. Mass customization, killer app has got to be printing a tailored part for an implant for somebody. And again, this is my point. Don't just use this new technology to make the stuff we've always been making, but we're just making it in a different way now. To answer Shane's question, there's a huge amount of hype around it. It's absolutely, everybody's talking about it. When we went into it, we realised how far behind the rest of the world Ireland actually is. Believe it or believe it not, we're years behind the Chinese at this stage. Now, we play catch up, but that's where we are. But it's not just all hype. There's a I think there's a huge future in it. And as I said, look, we've made a fairly serious investment in it. So, any questions? Geez, I either did a very good job or a very bad job.
Just a very good one. Do you see it ever breaking out to 2D, repeated 2D, to actually going 5-axis 3D printing, real 5-axis printing? Jerry's technology.
Jerry's technology, yeah. It has in some regards. There's the stereolithography world is a bit more than just... It's more than just 2D layers. If you think about building the solid material in layers, it is 2D printing. Build a layer, start again, build a layer. But with stereolithography, it's constantly building. It uses photosensitive gel. I'm not hugely familiar with stereolithography, but it's a constant process. Now, I know there's another process similar to stereolithography that's extremely fast, and it's been developed over the last 12 months. So, but I don't know enough about it. But I can't see a way that it'll move in FDM and DMLS. I can't see a way that it'll move anytime soon anyway. Unless anybody else can contradict me now, but from my toe in the water.
I think we can talk about that on the discussion panel, so there might be some more comments on that. So if Eoin wants to pop up now. So we'll have a panel. Eoin is from the Medical Device Design Research Group in UCD. So he's going to give us some of his experience on 3D printing and also how it relates to medical device design. So.
Thanks very much, Shane, and thanks very much to IMechE for the opportunity to talk here today. So, as Shane mentioned, I'd like to give my perspective on 3D printing. A lot of us here are interested, a lot of the speakers are interested in medical device components. So I'm going to try and steer my talk slightly differently away from what we see as a very promising area, additive manufacturing of metal printers, but just to give you examples of how 3D printing has impacted on how we run projects within our lab. This slide here, it gives a lot to take in, but the point I just want to make with this, these are projects that I've been involved in over the past number of years, and rather than fixing in on any specific part of the body, we try and come up with solutions to clinical problems that are proposed to us by clinical collaborators. So we're generalists in that regard, not particularly focused on orthopedics or soft tissue, but really try and identify what the key problems are and then come up with solutions to those. And usually in our case, they take the form of mechanical solutions. So the projects then within the lab, we categorize them in three main areas: a focus group around delivery and sensory devices. These can be microneedle devices, needle access devices. Then we do some work on implantable devices. I worked in the past on some stent-based technologies, and we're interested in seeing how additive manufacturing is going to change that area. And then also another area of recent interest for us is external assistive devices. And here we see huge potential for 3D printing in terms of developing next generation orthotics applications in universal design and patient-specific design. We're also interested in applying the knowledge we're gaining there to the area of soft robotics, which is an exciting emerging area as well, another low-cost technology where ultimately we'd like to have more active orthotic devices in the future. So I'm just going to start off by giving one example of a clinically led problem that we've experienced, talk you through that, and then going to talk about some examples of where 3D printing is of benefit to us. So I mentioned we usually start off with a clinical problem. Here, the problem we're facing is a common problem associated with needle insertion. And that's when you insert a needle into a target cavity. It could be a blood vessel. We like to use the Capri Sun analogy for this. The risk is that you're going to insert the straw or the needle too far and penetrate through the back wall. But the consequences inside the body are a lot more severe. A lot of you might have given blood at some stage, and the standard of practice there is to penetrate through the back wall of the vein and then retreat the needle. So naturally enough, you can end up with a large bruising or hematoma. There are a lot of other indications that we've looked at, epidural needle insertion, and really the problem here is that excess momentum causes the user to sometimes overshoot that So this is our standard process. We have a clinical need, we develop a prototype, and then we try and test it in an appropriate model. And here we're looking at this in a porcine or a pig tracheal model, looking at emergency access for an airway without the risk of damaging the back wall, potentially damaging your vocal cords. Here is, apologies for the quality of the video, is gaining access to a human, through the human peritoneal cavity for laparoscopic access is a common method of the first stages of keyhole surgery, where you're trying to safely gain access to the peritoneal cavity without risk of damaging underlying organs or tissue. So what you see there is the needle itself stops close to the interface, but a blunt stylet advances. So this is just an example of a technology we've been involved in developing, and it's a low-cost solution, which is an important part of a lot of what we do. We want to come up with simple solutions, test them, and then ultimately take these ideas to a stage where we can get other companies involved or other investors to either spin out the technology or license it to companies. And this leads me to what the general typical medical device design process here. Here's a slide from the FDA. We're really focused on here are the early three boxes here, and sometimes on the clinical side as well. But we want to take account of future issues like transfer to manufacturing, and also generate enough preliminary data that can be used for regulatory body submissions. So really a lot of early work on discovery and ideation, and then some early inventive process prototyping and trying out these technologies in preclinical models. So what I'd like to talk to you about on a day-to-day level, how 3D printing interacts with this whole process for us. And the systems I'm talking about, slightly different maybe from some of the other speakers, we're talking about low-cost systems that we can use on a routine basis in the lab. And here are a few examples of the devices that we routinely use. We wouldn't necessarily be confined to these, but these are low-cost solutions, generally equipment that costs from hundreds to the low thousands of euros. So it's quite affordable for a research lab to invest in this type of material, and the consumables are relatively affordable as well. So we use an Ultimaker, a modified Ultimaker system, which is fused deposition modeling based. We use a filibot as a means of producing our own mixtures of extrusions that we can use with this printer. And then we use a low-cost SLA printer, a Form 1 Plus. There's been some recent exciting developments with new technologies in the SLA space, really making laser and DLP printers a lot more affordable and suitable for either home use or use in a research laboratory. Okay, so with these systems in place, I'd like to just present a summary of where I see the key benefits, and I'll talk about each of those in a bit more detail. The first one here is on prototyping. The next will be on benchtop rigs and components. A third on anatomical simulators. A fourth on printing substrates that can be used for understanding basic research that can provide further design inputs for our devices. The direct printing of medical devices, which we'll touch on some aspects of that, and then to talk about how we can use this technology. We use it a lot in UCD as a learning and a teaching tool for our students. And ultimately, as we go through this process and we get students engaged with a new perspective on 3D printing, they're coming up with the new processes, new ways of modifying printers and developing new forms of material configurations. So here's an example from our medical device design class last year. I see some of the students here from that. One of the teams came up with a new device for an alternative to traditional needle insertion, where they have this item called an introducer is mounted onto the needle. So traditionally within this type of class, they would have drawn up this in CAD. They might have had some nice sketches, but creating some type of functional prototype would have been really challenging, say within a teaching environment or within short time scales. What this facilitates us to do is they're very quickly able to use an FDM printer to create a scaled up version of the needle that could be used for some functional assessment, for some ergonomic testing, and also to provide as a demonstrator for clinical collaborators. So a clinician might say, we have a current problem with the process. What we want to be able to do is prototype early and often and come up with components or a demonstrator that we can provide to them for some quick feedback. Other examples that 3D printing has allowed us to get involved with is being part of larger projects. Here is an example of some recent publications where a collaborative group with Harvard hospitals, we were involved with developing delivery devices for delivering biodegradable patches to the wall of the heart, so both for internal and external cardiac applications. So the technology behind this, a lot of the really exciting stuff is on the biomaterial patch and glue that we're able to deliver to the heart, and we use a UV curable glue to help it adhere to the internal walls of the heart. Where 3D printing comes into this for us is at the back end. So we're able to rapidly create handles and devices that can be used to facilitate this type of entry into animal models. So traditionally that would have been a very expensive process. We would have had to outsource that and have gotten significant funding for the molded components associated with that, maybe subcontracting someone else to do it. But now that type of work is a lot more affordable. It's lowering the cost of our research, and it helps us to be involved in these types of projects with more dramatic outputs. So here in this, we're controlling two separate balloons. An optical fiber shines the light against a patch and cures a UV adhesive. And we're trying to control that externally with a handle that's hidden away in this picture here. Okay, so just to summarize, with each of these, I've highlighted, just from my perspective, in green are areas that I think the technology is doing well, and in red are areas where I feel that we could benefit from some improvements. So from a prototyping perspective, I see this as affordable and rapid, allows us to prototype early and often. There are some material and size scale limitations, and often through initial materials we've suffered from poor mechanical performance. So we might have something visually or aesthetically, it looks okay now with SLA, but there are new materials evolving, more rigid polymers that are helping create more robust and functional devices. Okay, here's an example, just a simple example within the lab when we're creating simple benchtop rigs and components. We might want to cast some silicon tubes, create some benchtop rigs that allow us to determine a catheter's functionality, and we can use 3D printed components to facilitate this. So often they're a low-cost alternative and an instantaneous alternative to traditional machining. For a lot of the work that we do, where we're concerned with delivering devices to soft tissue and trying to replicate great benchtop models for that, we have to use indirect casting methods, because a lot of the soft materials that have evolved so far don't have the correct durometers to match biological tissues. And that leads on to this interesting example, which was presented by a student in the School of Anatomy last week on anatomical simulators. So these are devices, if a student is getting trained on how to intubate or insert a tube into a patient that's not breathing, these are the types of anatomical simulations that they'll learn this process on. And what we'd like to be able to do also is, if we develop new intubation devices, we'd like to be able to test them in a repeatable manner. So what they were able to do in anatomy was using a library of files, they had accurate scans of the anatomy. I think they also found that they looked at the percentage of accuracy of this anatomical simulation, and they thought it was, I think, maybe 30 or 40% accurate. So it's quite a generic geometry. It's a molded component. But here, through 3D printing, they now have the possibility of creating patient-specific anatomies, or if there's any specific pathology or a high-risk group that make intubation particularly difficult, they can match certain anatomies to that. So it's a high-quality training tool. And when we test devices, we try and create benchtop models or anatomical simulations outside the body. We want them to be repeatable so that we can compare devices directly. So they've created some very nice structures and combinations of 3D printing and casting of silicone to replicate these types of structures. And here you see in that middle image there is the where they're trying to insert the intubation tube. Okay, so just to summarize again on that, we see that repeatable mechanical performance is possible for direct device comparison by using these types of anatomical simulators. The modularity can facilitate patient-specific accurate anatomy, and that really wasn't possible before. Where this technology would benefit a lot, and I think the holy grail for 3D printing is to take the scan of a body and through a certain degree of knowledge and looking at thresholding pixel gradients to be able to 3D print something that has both soft and hard tissue components where those mechanical strength will correlate to that of the native tissue. And that's really, it's a long way off, but these types of simulations are getting a lot better and a lot more affordable to make. Another area where we see 3D printing working indirectly for us is that in creating substrates on which we can study the behavior of cells. So one thing of interest to our research group is how cells respond to mechanical loads. So that's quite important when we're putting devices inside the body. We want to see what the cellular response will be on a mechanical level. So we use 3D printing to create molds for silicon tubes, different substrates. When we're creating, shown on the right there, types of lab-on-chip style systems, we can use 3D printing as a easy tool for casting PDMS off that we'll use routinely in these devices. We see that with this style of approach, there's an improving range of biocompatible materials, so we can now grow cells directly on a lot of the materials that are 3D printable. But we see some size-scale challenges traditionally. I'll talk a little bit about how some of those are being addressed. And also a real challenge in this area is ideally we would like to print substrates or materials that have the same mechanical properties of the tissue themselves. Okay, the fifth area I'd like to mention briefly is direct medical device printing. So I'm not going to dwell too much on the metallic images here. These were produced in collaboration with our colleagues in U3D. So I see Peter up there, and thanks for your help with those. So what we do early on is we try and prototype new concepts or see an area of interest for us is in microneedle technology. So we want to see where additive manufacturing is at the moment in creating molds and devices for microneedle-based technology. The area that I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about is on customized orthotics. And where we see the advantage is here really for direct medical device printing is some of the design freedom that was spoken about earlier. So having mechanically gradiated components, being able to produce different macro and micro structures within the same device. But some of the challenges that we're facing and have to work on going forward are providing better process control. So we want to be able to benchmark the performance of these devices versus casted or molded components. And really the regulatory challenges with these types of custom devices are quite significant, and that's something that the FDA and the CE in Europe have been dealing with. And there are now a stream of devices that have been approved that are 3D printed. We still see higher costs obviously associated with a lot of the metal-based additive manufacturing processes. But as I mentioned, it's interesting to see that the question about hype, 3D printed medical devices are already here. So as of August this year, there's 85 devices approved that are produced using 3D printed methods. And also interesting, an area of that is of interest for us is combining devices with drugs. So there's been the first 3D printed pill is now approved by the FDA. So there's a drug used for the treatment of epilepsy, and they're able to vary the porosity of the pill. So that notoriously, I think, for epileptic patients, they react differently for drugs and may require different dosings and have different absorption rates. So it allows some element of customization with medication delivery, which is another exciting application for additive manufacturing. So in this space, linking points 5 and 6, so an example of where we've used direct medical device printing and also used it as a learning tool has been in collaboration with the UCD volunteers overseas. So UCD VO, and they provide opportunities for UCD staff and students and alumni to work as volunteers in disadvantaged communities. And they operate in five different countries where they identify specific needs where they feel that volunteers could help. So this aspect of the research in the lab is led by Dr. Shane Keaveney and Colin Kyo. And there were two pilot projects this year, one in India and one in Uganda, where we sent 3D printers with students. And here are some summary slides and how they got on. So Paul Crozier went to India. And here in India, Paul really focused on the potential of 3D printing as an education tool for students there. So when he went to a school there and also an orphanage, and it's a fairly low resource setting, very isolated community. So using online resources, he's able to download different learning tools and files that he can use with the students, and also show them a new form of technology, train them on the 3D printers. Another student, Emmett Walsh, went to Uganda, and his focus there was on creating orthotics and prosthetics with a local expert. So he was involved in 3D modeling and printing training. So Emmett's background wasn't in engineering, but he found the Ultimaker a fairly user-friendly process, and he was quickly able to use it and apply it to real-world applications. So here is an example of a patient they came across where they wanted to perform a corrective procedure on their wrist. They were able to print this type of a cast, and they could quickly fit it. So this is just one example of what Emmett has been working on over a few weeks in Uganda. And there are other exciting examples of different devices he was able to make in a patient-specific manner. So there's a lot of resources online with these types of devices. There's a Thingiverse, a universe out there, a database of different types of designs that people can customize for potential solutions. And the software is becoming more and more user-friendly for wide use and easy training. Okay, so here are examples of some other devices. There's another hand that Emmett printed. I don't think he got an opportunity to fit it, or he had to leave before it was being fitted. So with this work, we would really like to expand this program and send out Ultimakers to more, or other 3D printers to more locations in 2016. And we'd like to look at new models for material sustainability, so that if we're able to deliver a printer to these low resource sites, they're able to identify power sources and materials that are compatible with 3D printed units, and so that it can be more of a self-sustaining model once people are locally trained on that. We're also interested in developing new functional print models and more advanced materials in association with this. We'd like to partner with some charity groups, hopefully, and we're in the process of looking to partner with 3D printed firms to roll this out at a larger scale. So just on the learning and teaching side, on a practical perspective for our own students, we see students now are able to assemble and disassemble a 3D printer at ease. So there's excellent learning opportunities there in terms of designing machines, a lot of this learning is autonomous. There's great online resources, troubleshooting YouTube channels available to help people and a strong maker community. I think to apply this to low resource settings, we need to be able to come up with some self-sustaining solutions. So some of the issues our students had were unreliable power supplies, unreliable internet communications, and so on. But these are definitely surmountable problems. In the area of novel process and material configurations, this is a new area for us. And what this links to is you guys, the young engineers out there. So what we're trying to do is assemble a team with expertise who've grown up with this additive manufacturing process. And you will be the leaders in additive manufacturing in the future. So a couple of key members of the lab with strong expertise in this, you've already heard from Shane. He did his PhD in CNC machining and is now looking to apply what he's learned there towards additive manufacturing and low-cost solutions, hybrid CNC processes, and so on in our lab. Another example is Fergal Coulter, who's recently joined our lab, and he does a lot of work on complex 3D printing of complex structures. So this is just to highlight to you guys that traditionally, a lot of us will stand up here and say our background wasn't in 3D printing, myself especially. We look at more the applications of 3D printing, but there's the opportunity really out there to become leaders in this field, which is going to be an incredibly exciting one. So from my perspective, is it all just hype? I think that really just depends on your expectations, because for me, it's been able to deliver in multiple areas. So I'd like to thank my own research group and the anatomy research group and the CARP lab where the needle technology I presented was developed, and these companies and organizations for their help and support. Okay. Thanks.
I'd like to thank Eoin. We won't have any time for questions because we're a bit over time. So if Colin could, where's Colin? There, sorry, yeah. If you want to jump out there. So Colin Kaler, he's from Arcam, so that would be one of the leaders in additive metallic printing, and he's going to tell you all about their technology now, but it's quite exciting, so we'll bring up your presentation, and we can, yep, here we go, down there, so like that. Okay.
Hello there, good evening everyone. I'm Colin Cater, so from Arcam. As a supplier and manufacturer of the machines and the technology, we have a sort of lot of responsibility in trying to hopefully take this the hype stage that has been the sort of reputation in recent years to actual production. Arcam, this picture really is sort of all of the presentations, they start with this picture to show that whether it's a bunch of human beings or a sort of a group of very close people together, but it's really Arcam is quite a sort of family that's grown up in its entirety. I suppose the mission statement of Arcam is to provide cost-effective additive manufacturing solutions. We only specialise in metal components, and the main focus is always to do with the production. We've seen when in the early stage we wanted to try and produce parts for every industry, every type of application, but we've just seen that the main focus for Arcam and the main expertise has been based around the aerospace and the medical aspects to do with implants, so components and medical implants. The Arcam group is made up of three groups, of three services. We have the main company, Arcam themselves, that make the machines. We also have recently bought and realised that the key to all of the metal-based systems is to do with the powder. So we bought our own company, AP&C, so that we can actually control from source the powder. And we also have got our own manufacturing facility in the US, so we can actually go from the powder source by supplying the machines, and also the expertise that we can gain through a subcontract service. To bring in another phrase, EBM, electron beam melting, other additive manufacturing solutions that sort of Concept Laser, EOS, SLM, Renishaw. These are the four main competitors or users within the additive manufacturing field. And the EBM, the electron beam melting, is another additive manufacturing process, but it offers some significant differences and from hopefully what I can show you, slightly higher productivity. But it's working in conjunction with conventional processes. So the key benefits that we look for with the Arcam type EBM technology is, from some of the other presentations you've seen, to make parts lighter in aerospace, so we can actually make more efficiency there. We can build intricate designs into some of the parts with some advanced cooling parts. And to do with the medical side from the implant technology is to put added features in that can only be made through this process. And the improved bone growth really is to do with the external structures, sponge structures, which will I'll talk a little bit later through the presentation. So to try and look at the technology is to improve and increase the performance. So hopefully then the products that end up become quite unique to that customer and become more value to their companies. So the I know that this is to say we're replacing present technology. It's a bit of a bold statement, and I don't totally agree with it in one respect. What we're trying to do is to work alongside conventional processes, but hopefully gear people towards using additive manufacture to sort of make things slightly better, redesign things. Some of the earlier presentations we've seen are how you take a part that's currently made, and then you can try and sort of make it so that it can be used for additive manufacturing. So to try and make things with reduced material and make it more efficient is really some of the key things to reduce the overall costs. Again, I mentioned the powder. So this APNC company that we bought recently have now opened up another manufacturing atomizing plant, because those of you may or may not be familiar with the technique, how powders are made. It's through a plasma or gas atomizing process, and from that you can get graded powders that then can be used for various techniques. And the thing that Arcam found very, very critical is obviously if you can control the powder from source, you can then have a full traceable route for any quality issues, and you've got that total control. And the same with this manufacturing, contract manufacturer that we have over in the US, is that we can then, the proof of the pudding is being able to build parts that people want. So if we've also got a subcontracting service, we can hopefully then support our customers. This is quite an important picture from my perspective, because right at the top in the middle you've got that little box graph where it says Arcam CAD to Metal Limited, and that's the UK. So it's having a facility and a centre in the UK that is so important to Arcam that they see that they do need to have a base here. There are three centres of expertise for Arcam. There's one in China, one in the US, and one in the UK. So it just goes to prove that from a little small island, that from Arcam's point of view, we're seen as one of the most key accounts for Arcam worldwide. And if you look at all of the metal-based additive manufacturing suppliers, whether it's, like I say, EOS, Concept Laser, Renishaw, SLM, and Arcam, they're all European. Traditionally, the 3D printing technology was invented in the US, which is all the polymer based. But all of the metal expertise seems to have been centered around Europe. So from the UK's point of view, we actually see having a center here is quite important. And this covers the UK and Ireland, obviously, from, well, not obviously, but yeah. So that we've recently set up this facility. We've got 7 people in the UK, a couple of application engineers. We just took the second on, a few service guys, and we have our own support service in the UK. So the machines themselves, we keep looking at this and saying this is quite a mature sort of process from what people's understanding is, but it's the first system was only sold in 2003, so the ramping up of the production requirements is still based on still quite an emerging young process. The current machines that are supplied by Arcam are the ones that are circled here. There's an Arcam, an A2X, which is a machine that's been developed for R&D research, so it's to work with high pressure, high temperature materials, in canal materials, things like that. So the two machines that are generally supplied into the industry at the moment is one called the Q10, which is generally to do with medical implants, and the Q20 is to do with aerospace parts. So really it's a small machine and a large machine. And the Q20 machine, it's based on 350mm diameter, 380mm high. So it's a reasonably sized build chamber to build parts. All of the machines tend to focus in 90% of all of our applications to work with titanium. And on occasion, I might skip across to all of the sample parts we've got on the desk over there, and you're quite welcome to look at some of the parts later on. So all of the pieces that you see here are all titanium parts. For electron beam melting, like I said, if you have four or five laser-based systems and one electron beam system, what's the differences and why may you choose electron beam over a laser-based system? I think the most important thing to start off with is the actual speed of the process. It's a much higher energy process than lasers, and considering we're after productivity, we want parts on the machine and off the machine as soon as possible. So with a higher energy system with electron beam, we are actually building probably 4 to 5 times quicker than most of the laser-based systems. We work in a vacuum environment. This has particularly importance to do with working with titanium, to do with the material properties, and also to do with the ability to create very, very high density parts. The heated environment is also critically important to work with titanium. Titanium, as a material to additive manufacture, has a lot of built-in stresses. So if you raise the heat within the build chamber, you can virtually eliminate these stresses. And the heating within this environment is actually to over 600 degrees. And we can create this heat by actually using the electron beam to not just melt each layer, but heat the powder around the outside. So we're actually heating the whole of the build chamber over the whole height of each part that you're making. Some other systems, they just heat the base plate, so then you lose that heat as you start to build higher parts. So the electron beam is used to heat the build chamber and also melt each layer. This means that the parts that when they come off the machine don't need any heat treatment. The other thing which is critically important, which I'll show you through on the next couple of slides, is the ability to stack parts for production. You mentioned earlier about building in 3D. Well, we're actually building 2D parts, but we can build parts on top of each other. So we're actually building using the full 3D environment of the build chamber. I mentioned just that we don't need post-heat treatment. So once the parts have cooled down, they can be taken straight off the machine. And the other feature is because we're building parts without stresses, we don't need to use support structures in the same way, so that the support structures are used just to evacuate heat. So in other words, that once the parts are cooled down, we can just take the parts off. So we can eliminate another process within the chain that's generally associated with metals, which means that you normally have to use wire erosion to cut the parts off the platform after heat treatment. So these are two post-processing techniques that we can avoid. This is a really interesting company. It's a startup company. They've been set up 18 months ago. It's a New Zealand company, Zenith Tenneker. And when they bought the first machine 18 months ago, they were so enthusiastic to start building parts with it, they now ordered their third machine to build parts with using the electron beam. And this is the key production benefit that the electron beam can offer, is the ability to build parts, stack parts together. In this example you can see here, 400 parts have been built in 38 hours, and you look at the CAD preparation time, it's 3 hours. Now the reason for this is we're working with a company called Materialize, that those of you involved in 3D technologies are aware of. And some of their SLA type nesting algorithms we can now start to work with the Arcam and the metals. So this is quite unique to Arcam, but this is all geared towards production. The fact that you can actually build that platform of parts in 38 hours, once the parts have cooled down, you don't need any heat treatment and you don't need any wire erosion after this, means that the productivity is very, very high. The medical applications, again, it's been spoken early on, is to do with the implant. In this case, this is a report that anybody can pick up if you want to. This is just a snapshot of some of it, to do with some of the adaptations that can be made through sponge and lattice structures. This is to enable bone growth in medical implants. And the one common one, if you typed in acetabular cups and Arcam, you'd find lots of information to do with this type of application. It is a very key production adopter using the technology, and there are over 50,000 people walking around with these fitted inside their bodies. And I'll just, not too quick. So this is an example of an acetabular cup. That's directly from the machine. And on the outside surface, you'll see there's a 3D printed sponge structure. Now, you can't get away from just building this and just using it directly. It still has to go through conventional machining processes. But this shows you how the parts are built. So you're building them on top of each other, stacking the part. If you imagine on the build platform of these, there's six there, so there's four sixes of parts all built at the same time. Now, it means that the individual 3D print time, should we use the phrase, that's down to 45 minutes for one of those when you build them as a stacked part like this. So that this technology is used really to give you very, very highly detailed digital castings, because you would still have to post-machine the parts here. But the fact you can actually build them quite quickly, you don't need heat treatment, and these parts will just break apart after you finish them, and then you can go straight onto the process of just going directly to machine. So the gearing and the use of additive manufacturing in metals, certainly from the Arcam side, is from a production point of view, it means that when we start to ramp up the requirements, that hopefully you need less machines to be able to sort of keep the supply going through. So this is, I keep emphasising, it's a key feature. From an aerospace point of view, just quickly, this is quite a prime time towards the end of the year, because what we've actually will have flying by the end of the year is an engine with 48 turbines that have all been additively manufactured using the EBM technology. And again, what we see is the way that all of these suppliers into the industry are starting to see how this can then be rolled out into further production. Having parts that can fly, having collaboration partnerships, as in this example you see here through GKN, with a strategic additive manufacturing partnership, which is a 5-year program to develop the technology for aerospace, just goes to show, hopefully, the fact this isn't just hype, this is real industry, this is real technology that's being advanced. I suppose this is one of my last slides, and I quite like this picture here. This is showing you where the technology is heading. We can see more ambitious projects. We can see implants here where we have sort of rib cage and spinal sort of implants. We have, it was mentioned earlier about sort of we're a little bit behind in China. Well, we can see that this is going to roll out quite quickly with certain FDA approval that have now been agreed in China. and this is an Italian company where they've ordered recently 5 more Arcam systems to hopefully keep up to the ability and the requirement for all medical implants. So just a selection of some of the users that are generating the future developments of additive manufacturing and certainly with the Arcam process. It's a short sort of presentation, that bit, because a lot of the things have already been covered by some of the other exhibitors, presenters earlier on. But you're quite welcome to ask any questions on some of the parts that we've got down here. The big acetabular cup is just to show you the various structures. It's not from an elephant. But, okay, so thank you all very much, and any questions?
So our next presenter is Emmanuel. He's a biologist from UCD, and he has quite an interesting presentation coming up. It's going to be quite different to our previous ones, so I'm looking forward to it. So, Emmanuel, I'll hand over to you.
Thank you very much. Good night, everyone. So it's a bit strange to be in an engineer settings, but never mind. So I'm a biologist and I'm French, and I could not resist to have a bit of French writing, even though it's a Belgian painting, but that's okay. And I will not mention the main thing on Sunday, we will get along with that. So the title is This Is Not the Heart, because at the end of the talk I'm going to go towards discussing bioprinting, the things we have been starting moving on. I will mainly discuss one of the aspects of the 3D printing we're doing in the lab, which is the work we're doing on coral reef, and I will show some examples and I will pass them around as we go. But before, I have to warn you, this is not a normal talk. That's going to be not neat and nice. That's going to be provocative, because I think there's a lot of things to be discussed. So if you think you may have a heart attack, you may leave now, because after that's going to be too late and I cannot be blamed in terms of insurance policy afterwards. Thank you very much. So I'm the head of the AIR lab. The AIR lab stands for Renaissance, because my lab is a bit of a madhouse. I am a biologist by training, but I'm a polymath by nature, so I do a lot of things on many different subjects. So we have been doing laser nanosurgery in the past, so dissecting single cell with a laser after stretching it in order to separate organelles. And we have done quite a lot of work with this. We have been doing a lot of things on machine microscopy, which is a new type of 3D microscopy, developing a super microscope which is sold by Zeiss now for 350,000 euro if you want to buy it, and which allow to do large 3D imaging of bugs, even though we can build it in the lab for 6,000, but we're not going to tell them, we don't like that too much. We're doing 3D of animals, but we do also 3D of tissues. We have an interest of epithelia, which is one of the oldest tissue on Earth, which is also very important because it's in our gut, in our skin, in our eyes. So in terms of disease, this is a very important thing, and we are able to build artificial organoids or tissues using 3D printing by creating medical systems which allow us to basically grow any type of tissue we want in different orientation by prototyping those devices in the lab. And it's one of the main topic of one of my students, Peter, who is actually freaking out because he has to give his PhD tomorrow and he hasn't finished yet, so it's quite an interesting thing. But what I do is that, I just put that for Jane, you know, that's it. So this summer I was kind of forced to go to French Polynesia to work on a coral reef as part of a large project on climate change and protecting local environments and giving tools to locals to look after their own coral reef. And we use 3D printing extensively. What you cannot see is what I'm holding in my hand is a GoPro handle that you can print on the islands to get your GoPro and then to go on the beach. And the idea now that we're working with on chain is to use the plastic we collected from the beaches around the atoll to produce those parts which will be used by the locals to look after their own coral reef, because after all, I have a fair skin and spending too much time there is not very good for me on the long term, and being in Ireland is a better setup. We do a lot of things. We do 3D imaging on the large scale. So for example, this is me, this is Noel, and this is the kites over there, which is taking pictures, and using the parallax effect we are able to do 3D imaging on large coral reefs. So we do 3D imaging from 100 meter down to 1 micron. And we also work on museum imaging. Those are from the Museum of Natural History in Dublin. Those are glass marine invertebrates created in 1885, which are very fragile and you cannot see because they are on the balcony. And we're able to do 3D images of them and 3D printing some of them to have a replica. And we do also something, and that's because there is a QuickTime system which does not work, I have to show you how it works. And basically we also do a lot of work, because we do 3D images, we had to do 3D interactive visualization, and we'll use with CAVE, virtual environment space, where we can basically move our data move into our data and focal. So we go from 3D imaging down to 3D visualization of any type of biological object, mainly coral and epiphyta, and it's us basically navigating through a spheroid. And what you can see is two cells dividing that we can scale on. So we have an interest in 3D imaging down to 3D visualization. So now, the work of corals. So corals have been here before us. If it goes like that, they may be there after us. They have been the first epithelia and the most productive epithelia because they are able not only to produce large amounts of stone and lime, material that you can find in the Alps now and in somewhere over in Ireland, and they are very big producers of biological mass. You find them in different shapes. They are very complex animals to look at because their shapes depend on where they are, the way they support themselves, and you have very branching corals and lamellar corals. And the most part of the work I'm going to talk about is done by my student over there, Luis, which is over there and can talk to you if you want about his works. But the idea is we would like to do 3D imaging from the reef to the single symbiont within the coral. So, and we want to be able to integrate everything from there to there, so we can zoom infinitely down to the real biological object from the original large geological data. This is roughly possible. Prime satellites are bloody expensive. A kite is much cheaper, and we can do better than them with a kite. That's, we know how to do that. We're getting there. The colony I'm going to show you, this is possible. This underwater work, that works. We are here and now down to there, and I'm going to show you some examples of where we use 3D imaging and 3D printing for our work. So for example, basically you send your students to the Maldives for 2 weeks. Tough life. You choose a Mexican because he likes the sun, so he likes to go there. You give him a simple GoPro. So basically in the lab, the idea is everything which is available on Amazon is good enough for doing science. Everything more expensive, we cannot afford. To get a GoPro, do photogrammetry, which is basically swimming around the systems, and basically swimming around and isolating and doing the segmentations, doing that before you take the parts, then you do it after you take the parts, and so you can do a comparison between what has been taken by the diver and what is on the reef, which means that a year later you can come back to the same spot and do it again. So basically the idea is to be able to do digital oceanography rather than harvesting coral on the spot and being able to measure in real time, in real space, without damaging the organism. And you can even go further, and sorry but we had an issue with this, I'm going to show you what happens when you are able to integrate. So basically you get your model, very nice, you've been diving around, you basically get your model. Because you know how to deal with models, you'll be able to segment it. So you can measure the volume, measure the surface. 2 years later, you do it again so you can compare. You can measure what has been taken by the scientist. And because we can scan smaller, we can also scan the part which has been taken from this. We can even zoom further by doing some micro local photogrammetry, and everything is embedded within each other, and we have a constant end-to-end follow-up of a coral from the reef to the real object, and we can use that and print it to demonstrate the shape of the organism you get down to the part you have taken, which is very good for teaching, but also have some very good aspect for us in terms of measurement and volume ratios. This works pretty well, and basically you can go from the colony down to a single coralite, and coralites are important in corals because you cannot identify the species without looking at that single little cup. This is where the species is defined. This will never tell you which species it is. You have a guess, but you have to always be able to go from the colony down to the single coralite, and it's very pretty imaging and 3D printing is very good for us because we can actually do this entire thing, because we can even extract the chlorite and 3D print it in order to check this is a specie. But that also gives us the possibility to do automated taxonomical analysis of corals coming from anywhere in the world, as long as we have a 3D data set. Meaning we don't have to move the data, we don't have to move a sample, we can just use digital identification, limiting the numbers of damage to coral reef. We can do that at the colony level. So for example, museum collection can be done digitally and then can 3D print it, so you can have a copy of that in your fish tank, if you like. You can even write your name in the middle, which is very nice. And that is a very nice tool for teaching, but also for other species. And currently we are doing some comparison, Luis is doing some comparison on what is the best way to 3D print corals for different use, for teaching, because for example, when you teach a coral zoology, you have to show the student what is a coralite. And sometimes they are so very tiny that it's very difficult. By being able to blow them up, we are able to basically show in detail what is a colony compared to a substrate. The problem is printing in white is bad. We realize that printing in gray gives more shadows. But what we would like to do is to print the real object. And this is not possible in 3D printing, because what you get those things. What we want is that. So that is fact is a 3D printed corals that my students spend sometimes basically painting, and if you can use that, you will see the symbionts one by one, which are the real object you will see in a corals when you look at it. You see those green things? I can probably show you in more details. What is bright green is the symbiont, the algae, which is in it. So we have developed a technology in the lab which is using 3D printing and something else to get the real object. And that's what has been debated. 3D printing is good for certain things, but you need more afterwards to actually get the parts you want. And there's still a lot of problem with 3D printing. You usually print only one thing. One material, multiple material are difficult. Coming from one layer to another layer is always complex and doesn't really match and works. And it's where I think 3D printing has a long way to go before we get to the point, because we need to work multi-material, multi-technology, multi-type of filaments. And I can pass that around. It's going to be a bit difficult to look in the dark, but we had to paint the real object to be able to get to a final point of education tool on what is a symbiont within the chlorite and how does this work. Basically, what you're going to see is this. This is the real corals under fluorescence, where you can see all those single dots, which are single algae or symbionts, which give you the possibility to know if coral is healthy or is going to die. And when it bleach, basically what happens is all those guys are kicked out by the corals, and then the corals turn white. We also do things in zoology, and recently we have been dealing with that guy. So that's a guy in a pot. So it's a deep sea crab which has been collected south out of Ireland a few years back, which came from 2,000 meter depth. And nobody knows exactly which specie it is. And we decided to use 3D printing and 3D scanning to turn it into a 3D model and to compare different type of crabs from different locations and also 3D print the guy. And here is an example of what it looks like when you do your 3D print, your 3D imaging, then your 3D printing. So this is 3D scanning and 3D, this is photogrammetry, yeah? This is photogrammetry. Basically, we can 3D scan at high detail this crab. We can send that to an expert in Paris, but using regular mail, so we don't have to put that in the regular post, which is not possible anymore, because if you put liquid, they will refuse it, which is annoying for us, so we cannot send sample anymore. So we send digital sample. The expert, which is 65 years old and traveled around the world, has been able to do the identification, and we are able to digitally duplicate this crab anywhere in the world. And this is what you're gonna see is the next thing, is basically we sent this to our friend in Denmark, And this is the first plastic crab in a museum setting in Denmark. So basically, we use 3D technology and 3D printing technology to duplicate zoological specimen, and so like that, they are not damaged, they don't come out of the museum, they are safe, which means that if we can do the same thing during expedition, we don't take sample from the environment, we take a digital copy that we can after 3D print, because 3D printing is available, and give a possibility to distribute that around, and you can even have it in your fish tank or on your chimneys or whatever, or you can have it printed in fluorescent colors, whatever. But this is a way for us, a way forward in zoology, because we can do automated taxonomy on the 3D scanning, but the 3D printing gives us a possibility to have a very important tools for teaching and outreach, but also in terms of museum, we can share collection digitally and copying them in 3D printing rather than to have to spend a huge amount of money. If you have to make this crab based on the drawing, it costs about 6,000 to 7,000 euro to get a pure replica. 3D printing is 1,000 to get it well done. And we think we can go down to 100 in a couple of years. So it would be very easy for any type of teaching in universities to duplicate anatomical parts, but also zoological elements for any type of school anywhere using this type of approach. And here is the example. This is the image taken by the rov at 2,000 meters. This is the copy digital, and this is the replica in Denmark. So we have a full circle in terms of, and the next thing is to bring the 3D printing down with the rov next time and put it next to the others in order to, so we can see each other. But one thing for us in terms of coral work is the sensing. Sensing, what it means is when you're on a coral reef, there's a lot of information you would like to collect or to be able to look at over time. And 3D printing is a very interesting possibilities because the filaments we have available are giving us this possibility, and we think there's much more possibility in 3D printing, especially in the biological setting, is sensing. And here is an example which I've been done in collaboration with Shane, is we took this foliose coral we did 3D print it, and I brought it with me in French Polynesia. And what happened is each time it goes under UV, it turns violet. So if I take that when I dive, I know when the UV range is lower than a certain level, and I know that the coral I'm going to meet may have a different setup. It means I could implant some of those sensing coral on a reef, and when I pass by, I can see if there is a risk of coral bleaching in the coming years, or if you put that in a setting where there's divers coming every day, this can be seen as a sensor, a regular implanting sensor on place, or when you dive, you know that you have reached a certain depth. And I think UV is one of them, because it's the most commonly used sensing filament at the moment, which is not used in terms of sensing in the environments, but I think this is something where 3D printing could be very useful, because we could actually 3D print sensors which are very small, which can be carried with you, and which can give you automatically information without having any type of measuring device, but just the filament sensing what's happening. It could be used for UV, this is one of the examples, and this is, for example, this is very bright, and I should wear sunscreen, and I did, but that's a very nice picture, sorry, I could not resist. What we also done is this thing, is basically using a thermosensitive filament, basically these filaments change color at 30 degrees. For us, the interest, if those things change on a coral reef, it means there is a risk of El Nino events with coral bleaching in the coming weeks. So it could also be used as a temperature sensor on the reef to tell you that there is a risk of increase of temperature, which may have a problem on the reef itself. The good thing is you can 3D print. You can 3D print all of them. They are not very expensive, and you don't have to send a nice European white guy over there to do the measurement for you. You can 3D print on the sides, and you can use that and disseminate that across your coral reef, and as you go by, you just check. Done. We think there is more possibilities behind this, and we are exploring other possibilities, like pH is probably something which could be interesting. Could we combine those three filaments within one block, which could be deposited in an arbor, on the reef, at the back of a reef, on the beach, at different environments, in order to see what's going on, using just pictures or passing divers or fishermen to tell you what's going on. Here is the temperature sensitive one. We put them in a fish tank with sand, showing you what happened when the temperature shifts, and it's clearly visible, probably not visible enough. The range of temperature, it's far too narrow. We'll be interested in having rainbow filaments, which could evolve from 0 to 20, and you could have more information from them and be able to basically choose the shape you want to give them, because you have to put them in different settings and different environments. Now, is 3D printing a revolution? For my lab, yes. Why? Because it's cheap. It allows us to do a lot of prototyping. It allows us to do this type of guys, but it also allows us to build 3D scanners, like Ben has been doing for the summer. We have been doing microscope you can mount on your iPhone. We can explore a lot of prototyping, and prototyping in the lab has been very important. But now I've got a couple of things about revolution. This one is the first one. When I did my PhD a few years back, I was kind of a loser because I was the only one not doing gene therapy, because gene therapy was the revolution. Everybody will be saved. We will give you a gene therapy on Monday, and then you will get air back on your heads. You will be safe from cystic fibrosis for things like that. And 20 years later, there is only one single protocol for such a very rare disease that probably 4 people in the world are going to get cure from that. So yes, that was a revolution 20 years ago, and it's absolutely not a revolution now. Talking about revolution, that's 3 interesting revolution. The wheel, we can probably all agree that was a pretty bright idea, and this has been really a revolution, because with a test of time, we can clearly say, yes, that was a pretty good idea. The power drill, it's pretty good. I mean, when you see the number of house and things being built with a power drill, and power drill is used every day across Ireland, across workshops, probably power drill has done more to humankind than 3D printing so far. Yes, we can agree on that. Now, we have 3D printing. Yes, it may be a revolution, but there is a few caveats, and I'm going to show you an example. That depends on use and your capacity. Sorry to say. This is a computer. We all have a computer. Okay? Everybody has a computer? Yes? Okay. Who is able to build his own computer? Raise your hand. One. Who is able to build his own...
From parts, assemble, from chip...
From parts. From parts. I'm going to be nice. From parts. Okay. No, you see, suddenly, wow. Now, who is able to put his computer together and to code the program they're going to use with that computer? One. So that's basically summarizing it. You can have a beautiful tools, you can have a beautiful things. If you don't have a capacity to deal with it or to use it, that's not going to do a revolution. A lot of people doing 3D printing are buying a 3D printer, downloading things for Thingiverse, and basically making small little dolls for their daughter. And that's what 3D printing is for them, which is a very good thing. It's a huge market. We're going to make a lot of money. But for the rest of what they could use it for, I think I see a limited capacity, because beyond 3D printing, there's more knowledge needed to use a 3D printer. Because to use a 3D printer, you have to know about CAD, you have to know about making the models, how to tell them a model, how to also prototyping, because you start printing something, it doesn't work, then you do something else. So there's a lot of scientific works needed when you use a 3D printer in order to get that useful for your personal need. So now, there's a lot of things which are, in fact, illusion. And on internet and on TV, you get all those things, yeah, somebody has... One baby has been saved because they 3D printed the parts. Yes, but 10 days later they had to remove it because they had to make sure the tissue could regenerate, and this thing had to be cut down. So here is an example. You probably know that painting from Magritte, this is not a pipe. Yes, this is a 2D representation of a pipe. So yes, you can call it a pipe, but this is not a pipe. Yes? Those are fake. Nice. I put boobs and abs so we can share, because even though there's more money making in fake boobs, it seems that fake abs and fake muscles are going also on the thing. They look nice. They are based on insertion of something in your body. And I'm going to get from there to bioprinting and prostheses. And my main problem as a biologist, this costs money. You have to get them in, but 10 years later, you get to get them out. And sometimes sooner than later, because the one you got were not the right one. Or because you get on a plane and something happened with pressure. And so on and so forth. So when we deal with now printing parts for biology, and when I talk biology in general from animals to human, everything which goes into the body is artificial. This is not supposed to be there. Yes? Yes, it's nicer, it's made of titanium, you can do a lot of things, but this is not true. Often when you get a graft, you cannot do what you were doing before because you have limitation due to these particle prostheses you get into you, which has some limitations and also damage the neighboring. It has a cost, it has to be put, but sometimes you have to get a lot of drugs. For example, when you get artificial skin, it's up to 6,000 euro a week for you to survive for the last first 3 weeks because you have to be in intensive care. So yes, you're bringing something artificial into your body for you, but there's a cost and it's time. You don't make a heart in a day. It takes 15 to 18 years because you have to get the load, the physical load in the pump as you grow older. And there's a lot of things which have to be mechanically put in place for that to exist. So when we talk about bioprinting, yes, this is the printing. We can do 3D printing. We can 3D print a heart, a brain, a skull, replacement. But there's that tiny little thing in front within biology. And there's a lot of things we did not came out of the ground last week. There's a huge evolution process with a lot of genes involved for you to be here tonight and to be able to understand what I'm talking about. There's a lot of elements linked to this. So when I see bioprinting, I'm a bit skeptical. It's like, you know, oh yes, this pork has been biologically produced. Sorry, all pork are biologically produced. They are all biological animals. What is that bio-organic thing? They are all organic, for Christ's sake. Thanks very much. What is that? It's not because you put bio and organic that it's a miracle. No, it's not. So, how bioprinting works? That's fantastic. Basically, piece of agarose, so jelly jello, that you get from your local supermarket. You sprint it and you put cells in the middle. Yes, it's true. We all got sprinted out of a needle when we get born. Yeah, sure. Yeah, that's a bit of an easy one. And you could see that this is floating in air. Yes? I think 98% of our body is made of water. Why do you want to print in air something which is a water-based system? So when I talk about 3D printing, when I see that, I'm really, really skeptical about this. Yes, this is look like a heart. It's nice. Red. It's going to be perfect for Halloween coming over. But to make this, it normally takes 18 years. It takes up to 10,000 genes to be involved. Deposition made one after one, depending on the load. So people will have different hearts depending on their physical body mass and things like that. So yes, 3D printing is a revolution, but bioprinting is a far off target. Because, for example, one thing is everybody in bioprinting is printing hydrogel. But they're printing that in air. So first, there's clearly a problem there. If you print something in air, it's not going to work. The next thing is, for example, you print collagen, which is a very important thing. Collagen, the print, is coming out of a rat tail. Yes, it's ugly. They basically chop rat tails and they extract the collagen from that, and the collagen, you buy that and you print that. Rat tail collagen 1 is not my collagen. I don't want rat tail collagen into my body. And usually you print collagen in between two points. Your muscles are always anchored. So if you print collagen, what will happen to you the next day? Everything shrink, gone, your cells are dead. So what we try to do in our lab and collaboration with Brian Rodriguez from physics departments is try to establish a bioprinting systems for us to replicate the tissue we're working with, coral tissues, epithelial tissues. But to do that,
we have to be able to print the extracellular matrix, because around your cell, you've got a lot of protein. Up to 6,000 different types of proteins needs to build this space in between. And they are all different to the nanometer resolution between your eye and your toes, which is great, because your eyes doesn't look like your toes, because you have to organize that differently, because you have different physical load, different things. So we believe that if you know how to get that right, you just have to put the cells on it and they will do what is right, because we believe that the biological system we have been built with needs support and guidance, because my goal in the future, if I get grafted, I want that graft to be gone. I want me to rebuild me based on the cue I will implant in my body. It's why I don't like prostheses too much, because I think we should be smarter, and with now access to genome technology and 3D printing and rapid prototyping in lab, we should be able, with bioprinting, to go toward this, printing real tissues to the nanometer resolution, but there is a lot of things ahead of us which will require more than what we have here at the moment. So yes, it's a revolution in my lab, but my lab is a strange place. It's probably not going to work for everybody. So in terms of bioprinting, I think we are a long way to go. Thank you very much.
Okay, good evening, everyone. My name is Noel Harrison. I'm from NUI Galway. That's our engineering building there in the picture. I'm going to talk about additive manufacturing and how that's changing the game for medical device manufacturing at the moment. So my talk, I'm just going to give an introduction, first of all, to myself and my experience in additive manufacturing for medical devices. I've kind of identified three different impacts that additive manufacturing has in the medical device industry. I should probably state now as well that when I refer to the medical device industry, I'm pretty much talking exclusively about orthopedic devices, metallic orthopedic devices. That's where all my experience is, and that's basically what the presentation is on. And then I have just a couple of comments on the change in opinion within the industry, from my perspective as a researcher based in the university for the last 7 or 8 years or so on. So, as an introduction then, I did a degree in mechanical engineering and a PhD in biomedical engineering, and as part of that, did a bit of work on one of these machines here. That's called a sinter station. It's basically a 3D printer, a laser-based 3D printer. Selective laser sintering is what SLS stands for. We have one of those, we had one of those, we still have one of those back in NUI Galway. That could only do one material, PA12 or nylon, and the kind of work we did on it back then, there's a picture there of a blown up model of tubercular bone. So tubercular bone is that kind of porous honeycomb bone structure that's inside most bones, and you'll always find it at the load bearing part of a bone. So it's quite an important bone component, and that's the part that degrades basically when somebody gets osteoporosis. So it's an important part of the bone structure. And what we were using it for, or what we were using the 3D printing for back then, was to allow us to do multiple testing modes and failure, testing to failure modes of the same bone structure. The problem with testing bone samples is that every bone sample is unique. So once you test it and fail it in one particular direction, you can't get it back. You can't test and see how that same sample would have performed in a different load. So what we did back then was make multiple models, scale-up models of the same geometry, and we could basically test that in different directions. So that was the first kind of introduction I had to 3D printing, going back a while now. From 2007 to this year, I have worked on orthopedic device development. So this has been, as well, within NUI Galway. It's all been Enterprise Ireland funded. It's been developing two technologies. I'll talk about both of them tonight. One of them is OsteoAnchor, and the other one is OsteoHipFix. And within that, we did a lot of work in the early days, particularly with EOS. So they're one of the companies that were mentioned earlier. They're one of the producers of DMLS machines. So as described earlier, DMLS is a variation of 3D printing. It uses laser power to melt the metallic powder, separate to EBM, which is what Colin talked about, that uses basically like an electric arc, kind of like a, rather than a laser, a slightly different technology, but broadly speaking, it's the same process. And So as I said, I'll talk about that in just a little bit. But right now, I'm working on, or getting into working on, fundamental research into additive manufacturing materials. You'd be forgiven for commenting why the fundamental research is coming after the applied research. It's just the way it worked out. My experience in additive manufacturing applied device development has, I guess, spurred on an interest in better understanding of the fundamental micromechanics. So the actual grain structures that are produced in 3D printing are quite unique. So that's where my research is based at the moment, kind of pre-device. What I'm really looking at is obtaining fundamental micromechanics understanding of additive manufacturing to enable the next generation of 3D printed parts. So I'm going to talk about three impacts that additive manufacturing has in the medical device industry, and these are now evidence, they're not kind of aspirational. There's evidence of these. The first one is a new product design. So as was mentioned by Jerry and by Jonathan earlier on, the additive manufacturing brings its own design for manufacture rulebook. So classically, engineers, as Jerry described earlier, should always think of how a part's going to be made when they're doing the design process. So classic production methods like machining or casting or so on have certain requirements and restrictions or guidelines, but additive manufacturing basically gives us new design freedoms. So there's parts that just couldn't be made in other processes. It's not plain sailing, or it's not a clear horizon. There are new design limitations and considerations, particularly to do with build supports and the thermal processes that happen in an actual additive manufacturing build. So these things need to be considered when design for additive manufacturing is been undertaken. But overall, it offers a considerable opportunity for new product solutions. So the thing at the bottom there, it's not a medical device, it's just a pretty cool design produced by additive manufacturing methods. I'm not sure is it EBM or DMLS or what, but it's just to demonstrate that to produce something like that using existing production methods would be quite prohibitive, but you know, additive manufacturing, it would be very straightforward. So as an example of new designs and new design capabilities, again in the medical device space, I'm going to give an example from really from my own experience, and that's in cementless implants. So I'm talking about here are your classic hip replacement or knee replacement. The picture shown there is of a hip replacement. So cementless means that there's no cement being used, obviously, but what that requires is for that implant to work long term, the bone has to attach onto the implant. So as was mentioned earlier by Colin as well in his presentation, the idea of porous structures and the ability for bone to grow into, that's what we're talking about. We're talking about improving the performance of cementless implants. So fundamentally, for a cementless implant to work, you need the surface to have the simplest measure is a high friction coefficient, and that basically gives us the immediate stability of an implant once it's inserted. So that's kind of right on the operating table. How secure is that implant in? I don't know if any of you have ever seen a hip replacement surgery. You can see them on YouTube, but it's pretty much carpentry. It's kind of saws and hammers and mallets and so on. And when the implant goes in, you generally see the surgeon giving a little wiggle to see is it secure. So that's what he's checking to see, has he got that immediate fixation, and then the long-term stability. So this is the stability for 10 years, 20 years time frame. That comes from the biological process where the bone grows into the implant. So that's what you need. So that's basically, from an engineering point of view, that's your design criteria. You want to produce an implant that has high friction for immediate stability and porous for long-term stability. So what they used to do to address this is using implants or technologies like this. So what you see there is an implant from, I think that's a Dupuis AML stem, and the SEM image there is of the surface. That's called beaded spray. So that technology, it's very effective. It gives us a rough surface. It gives us pores between the beads, but it's actually a very simple technology. So I have a picture there of a pebble dash been carried out, and that's really what it reminds me of, because that's how these implants are made. They heat up these beads and just fire them at a base implant, and that works fine. These implants are still in use, they're still the implant of choice of some surgeons. But looking at the next generation technologies which has come out over the last couple of years, there's basically a massive jump in the porosity and a massive increase in the friction that we get, but that has been achieved using advanced production methods. So that implant there is a tubercular metal implant from Zimmer, and its production method is, I think, vapor deposition, which is quite a costly and quite expensive, or quite time-consuming, method, and it involves different assembly steps of the implant. So that's really the second generation technology. That was kind of the goal, that is the gold standard still in orthopedic devices, cementless implants. So my work then in Osteoanchor was to, utilize additive manufacturing to come up with another solution, or a better solution. So this is what we came up with. So you can just see in the zoom in image there, basically the implant consists of a surface architecture which has two main features. The first one is a series of claws on the surface that are orientated in a particular direction. That's the direction that they want to be inserted in. So that's going to give resistance to subsidence and much improved stability. It also, because the claws are pointed in that particular direction, it won't hinder removal, which is important, because most of the surgeons that we talk to tell us they're not going to put in an implant if they don't think they can get it out again. So that was important. The previous technologies have multi-directional frictional properties, if you know what I mean. So the beads and that tubercular metal surface, that's rough in whatever direction you test it in. The second feature then is the interconnected pores. So that's basically voids, very similar to the kind of implants that Colin has shown. Again, they're all cementless implants. This is the same application, another take on it. You can see in some of the samples from Colin, actually, some of the pore structures are regular shaped and some of them are irregular. We were discussing earlier, that this is actually, I don't think there's any proven difference between a regular structured and irregular structured implants, but surgeons seem to like, and patients tend to believe the story that irregular structures look more like bone, so it's going to work better with bone, but I don't think there's any evidence of that just yet. So that's what our Osteoanchor technology looks like. So just quickly run through what we did. So this is going back to 2008, we're doing the first testing, so this was kind of, it was kind of novel enough in terms of looking at additive manufacturing back then. We had the same initial concerns with additive manufacturing and the properties, so we did some process parameter testing, so kind of varying the temperature, varying the kneading process that was applied to the implant, varying the orientation which parts are built, and tested that, and then varying the surface treatments that are applied afterwards as well. Also did some cell culture studies to work out what size pore do the cells like best, and what one gives us the fastest cell proliferation, and did some friction testing then. So as I said, friction is a measure, it's basically an industry standard measure. It's not surprising that our claws perform very well, and considerably better than the existing technologies, as you can see in the graph there. But that's because we're going above friction, we were getting this embedding action, which is what we wanted. We also did micromotion testing, so that was basically seeing if a full implant is put into a bone and loaded as a person would normally walk, so loaded cyclically, how much relative motion is there between the implant and the bone, and that's important. That's really important because there's a particular range of micromotion which is preferred. So basically we want very little relative motion between the implant and the bone. If you go above a critical value, you get a different type of bone ingrowth. You get fibrous bone ingrowth instead of hard bone ingrowth. So again, our implant, largely due to the claws, give us a much improved friction and micromotion results. And we also did an ovine hemiarthroplasty trial, so basically a hip replacement in sheep for 16 weeks, and we got full bone ingrowth. Again, that's all enabled by the significant improvement in initial fixation, and we got full bone attachment right into the inside of the pores. So, in summary then, osteoanchor is a new medical device technology. It gives a superior bench and preclinical performance. It's cost effective and scalable. They're not our implants, by the way. That's the picture I just got online. But it demonstrates that these implants can be mass produced even now compared to when it was in 2008. It's more cost competitive now, largely due to the competition in the market of additive manufacturing equipment producers, and the cost of the raw materials as well has come down. So there's more companies making powder, and there's basically the cost overall has come down from where it was a couple of years ago. So additive manufacturing has enabled new design features, and to make something like our osteoanchor up at the top there, that kind of size scale. So just to give you an idea, there's kind of about a millimeter spacing from tip to tip of each of those claws up there. So to make something like that using traditional methods would be completely impractical, if not impossible. But additive manufacturing is basically the key enabler for all that. Okay. So it's not just us that have made implants like that. So these companies are producing implants. They're out there in the market. There's over 70,000 of them implanted in people already. Colin mentioned Lima Corporate. There's another Italian company, Adler Ortho, as well, have implants out there made using additive manufacturing processes. And they're basically out there. It is interesting that these companies, they're kind of, we consider them second tier companies, that's largely to do with their size. So they're not the global kind of global leaders in orthopedics, but they're international companies, maybe operations and distributors in a couple of countries, excuse me. But they do seem to be stealing a march, and they were the pioneers, I would have to say, in terms of bringing additive manufacturing implants through the whole process basically and out into the market. So all these technologies here have new design features that were enabled by additive manufacturing. Okay. So the second impact that additive manufacturing has, or 3D printing has, in medical devices is it enables faster R&D. So that really goes back to the origins of additive manufacturing. So a couple of years ago, that would have been called rapid prototyping. That's where this kind of 3D printing technology emerged from originally. But if you were to consider the advances in materials and the advances in the equipment as well, and from an R&D point of view, or even in-house in the company or within an academic environment or so on, there's a significant ability to quickly produce implants, one-off implants, design iterations basically of technologies. So that enables very fast cycles from designing a part to testing it, seeing the results, seeing what needs to be changed, go back and make a new part. So this technology enables that rapid turnaround to occur, and it also is much cheaper because it avoids the tooling investment that is usually required. So here's some molds, investment molds and forging molds that would normally be produced for a mass production run, for product design cycles and new product development. These would be considered too costly to develop for a device that's not yet frozen. Okay, so additive manufacturing enables that quick turnaround without the investment in these kind of tooling. Okay, so an example of that is another technology that we worked on, OsteoHipFix. So I don't have a whole lot on it, but it basically, as a demonstration, we were able to go from computational design, computational modeling of our implants, build the parts, test them in the lab, and test them in cadaver setups as well, and basically look at the results, go back and redesign. So this is a massive capability for new product development. It's particularly good for I'd say probably academic-based research where time frames are quite short. This, I should say as well, probably, you know, brings with it a particular warning, as we found for some elements of our design. We found that the design features themselves could only be produced by additive manufacturing. So that wasn't necessarily our requirement or our design brief in this case. We wanted implants that could be produced generically, but I guess the design process got a little bit carried away with ourselves and a bit too creative, I guess. And we ended up with devices that are that could only, or one particular part of the device that could only be made by additive manufacturing. Now that's fine in some cases, but if you're competing competing against existing products that themselves are very low cost, maybe mass produced low cost implants, then additive manufacturing probably struggles there a little bit. But the fundamental point here is that it actually enabled the R&D in the first place to happen within a pretty quick time frame. So new commercial offerings then is the third thing here. So basically, it enables patient-specific implants and instrumentation. So what I'm not talking about here are the one-off. So what I mean by that is the things you might see on the news every so often of an army veteran who's had an injury and, you know, maybe part of a skull replaced, or, you know, other examples that you might see now and again of kind of one-off headline stories. What I'm talking here about is kind of the mass market for custom products. So there's one of the companies that are doing that already are called Conformis. So they're a company that make implants or standard implants. Well, implants for standard patients is what I should probably say. But their setup is that the patient goes in 1 week, gets their knee scanned. The scans are sent straight over to the company. They modify their design implants or their implants computer models, print them on the 3D printers, and not only that, do they print the instrumentation set to suit that patient, and then they send that back to the surgeon a week or two, or a couple of weeks later. So that's fine for this particular application, which would be an elective surgery, so it works quite well. And it's something that you wouldn't be able to do normally. It takes advantage of the scanning ability and the production ability. So in terms of the impact, as I said, it has led to new product design, faster R&D, new commercial offerings. What we wouldn't expect to happen with additive manufacturing is that companies would continue to produce exactly the same implant, only make them by additive manufacturing. And this is an interesting kind of conversation that we've had with some companies is, you know, that's generally the first thing that they might say when we talk about additive manufacturing. They might whip out an implant that they've, you know, been making for the last 10 years and say, how much would it cost to make this? And generally, additive manufacturing isn't going to win that argument, because if it can be made using an existing method, that's probably the cheapest way of making it. So in general, we wouldn't expect to see the same product, but that actually is not exactly the case, because as I explained in a second, probably what's happening more, or what did happen at the start, was the same products were being made by additive manufacturing, and the reason for that is to get over the main challenge of regulation, certification of products. So any medical device has to go through the certification process, FDA or CE, and within that, if a new product has been brought to market, it has to basically get approval. And the first thing that they'll ask is, well, is this device equivalent to existing devices? Or that's generally the implant production or manufacturer's aim, is to show that it's equivalent. So what tends to happen there is implant manufacturer isn't going to change everything, so they're not going to bring a new design and a production method to the market or to the regulatory bodies for approval. So they'll bring the same product, just make it a different way, and then down the line they'll bring a new product, but make that in the new way as well. So there is a bit of a delay. It's a natural stepping stone process, because we can only do one step at a time. But certainly, as Eoin mentioned earlier, there's a lot of products that have already got the CE or FDA approval. So that has enabled or basically opened the gates for every other manufacturer to start producing products using additive manufacturing. So in terms of changing opinions in additive manufacturing, so when we first started talking to companies and telling them about our ideas for additive manufacturing and what we were doing with, this is basically a summary of the kind of feedback we got. It was quite difficult, other than talking to the companies that are doing it themselves, to get any kind of traction in the main industry players. It was even difficult to get funding to do this kind of work, because when the funding bodies, when we went to them looking for funding to develop this, we had to get validation that the market had an interest in it in the first place. So that was actually hard enough to do at the start. a lot of people considered additive manufacturing as for tooling and prototyping only, which, you know, it was. That was the origin, but it had moved on. And there was also this inherent fear of inferior performance of implants, particularly metal implants made by additive manufacturing. And again, that's, you know, that's not, I'm not saying that was unfounded. What we actually did find is, yes, the performance is different, but it actually can be better. So part of the testing that we've done in the past was looking at the wear properties. I don't have any pictures of it here, I should have put them in, but we did find that DMLS-produced TI-64, so that's your standard titanium alloy for orthopaedic applications, had better wear properties than forged implants. So that kind of surprised us. We didn't think we'd get that. It surprised a lot of people. But it demonstrates that, yes, performance will be different, but you know what, can be better. So there's other elements of mechanical performance that are different and need further work, such as fatigue properties and so on. But this is just a demonstration that there's opportunities there. So more recently then, I guess probably around 2012, we kind of had a big push to up into industries about osteoanchor, and there was a clear progression within the industry and uptake and openness to additive manufacturing. And we got some very interesting comments, which I won't attribute who exactly they were from, but basically there was almost a dawning realization that additive manufacturing is here. And even the big companies, the global leaders, one of them gave a quote like, "I feel like the Kodak guy looking at digital pictures for the first time." If you don't know what that's about, it's basically Kodak are a classic case study of ignoring the emergence of digital photography. They believed that film was always going to be the leader, so they basically completely missed out on a major shift in the digital photography market. So we got questions, you know, more inquiries about additive manufacturing in general, not just about our technology, but about what they could do. You could see the wheels turning and them thinking internally, okay, we're talking about osteoanchor, osteohip fix, but they're thinking of other applications. And we're at a stage now where orthopedic or medical device companies are actually advertising that they want additive manufacturing engineers. So it kind of comes back to what was mentioned earlier about, you know, teaching additive manufacturing to engineers. They're definitely wanted. You can look on the various recruitment sites, but you will see medical device companies specifically looking for additive manufacturing engineers. There's no degree in that, but we need to include it, particularly in our engineering courses here in Ireland. Clear evidence then, yep, so companies have products based entirely on additive manufacturing, such as Conformis. Companies have some products made by additive manufacturing, such as these two mentioned. There's a lot of companies, particularly the big companies, the tier one companies, who are looking at additive manufacturing. They're not saying a whole lot. But what may happen in this space might be what happened in the automotive or the aerospace market, where similarly, most companies weren't saying anything, or they were in fact probably denying that they were working on additive manufacturing parts. And then all of a sudden, one of the big companies, GE, buys Morse Technologies, I think, who are a major additive manufacturing company. So there was all of a sudden, everybody's doing it. Everybody admits to doing it. So I'd say something similar will happen in orthopedics pretty soon. So in summary, is it all just hype? Well, first thing is there definitely is a lot of hype, and that's understandable, because I think it is the first general purpose production method that has been emerged in quite a while. The last one I can think of is casting, which emerged 6,000 years ago. I'm sure that caused a bit of hype in its day, the kind of stuff you can do. This is probably the next general purpose production method across multiple sectors, multiple materials, multiple applications. So that's understandable. But no, it's not, oh sorry, there's a bit of an overlap there. It's not just hype. It's already having an impact in the medical device industry. So thank you. Any questions?
Thanks, Noel. So if the five speakers, so Jonathan, Colin, Emmanuel, Noel, want to just come back up, we can start our discussion. So
sit in the back, you know.
This is a strong interview board.
Yeah,
we're interviewing them. Well, no, I want to keep close to the microphones as well, so. Okay, does anyone want to start off? So, question. Yeah, okay. Oh, Professor Byrne, yeah. Colin's coming to you now, sorry.
Thanks very much. Could I just ask Noel a question there, Noel? Thanks for the really interesting presentation. The micro claws that you've presented there, they almost appear to me to be like a cutting tool as you're inserting, and they're in that direction as well, so that you can take it back out. So do they not have an effect of cutting the bone and then essentially not sort of penetrating in the way that you would want it, or exactly what's the modus operandi of the microclaw?
Yeah, you're right in that they may look like they're sharp, but they're not actually that sharp. There's quite a broad triangular shape to them, so they do embed, but they don't subside. Without excessive force, basically. So they themselves are. I guess a lot of the design work went into the actual claw shape itself to ensure it didn't continue to cut into bone, that it basically goes into a particular point and then the cross-sectional area increases rapidly at the actual plane, if you like, of the interface. So you do get that immediate embedding, but it doesn't go any further.
I've got a question for the glue that was activated using UV light earlier on. I can't remember your name, I'm awfully sorry, but it's a very good talk.
Owen.
Yeah. I was just wondering if you studied the effect of like using UV light on the surrounding cells and why you chose UV instead of maybe a different wavelength.
Yeah, actually, well, so just to explain, I was involved in the delivery device development for those projects, and that technology is now spun into a company, Gecko Biomedical, that's based in Paris. So they've been doing a lot of work where they're rapidly accelerating and hoping to be in humans by the end of the year. They've, I believe, UV light source was probably used initially based on available photocatalysts and that they could use within the glue. And I would say that subsequently they have looked at other light sources. But it was a controlled amount of delivery time associated with that in the initial studies. And they did some histology studies to show minimal tissue damage around it.
I'll just wait till we get the mic, just so everyone can hear.
Hello. Just on the powders, they're probably very fine powders, so is there a lot of special handling needed to look after the powders?
There is, yeah. We have, in particular, like the titanium powder. Titanium's obviously reactive. It's almost like a flower. So the guys have full respiratory gear. I suspect it's probably the same for your technology, is it?
We use slightly coarser powders, so we're above the ignition point of titanium, so we don't need to go to quite the same level. So we don't. With titanium powder, sort of just static shocks could cause ignition, but we're above the particle size of that, but it's still a dangerous material to handle. So masks, all the sorts of fire protection, we tend to have to sort of consider.
The masks are more for protection of the user's respiratory system, but when we're printing in titanium, the build chamber is flooded with argon, so that eliminates the possibility of explosion or fire, but you still do open the chamber and you still are exposed to the powder. So to answer your question, yeah, there's a safety concern there.
Anyone else? At the back there.
Is it Jonathan from Schivo, is it? I was just wondering, from a commercial perspective, how you chose FDM from a polymer source as opposed to the other technologies, I suppose, from commercial. I would always have been taught that probably others offered better surface finishes. Just perhaps it was relationships with stratasys or different things, but how did you end up on FDM?
It was guided in a large way by our relationship with stratasys. The two technologies that we would have identified at the start were selected laser sintering and FDM. Now, when we partnered with stratasys, invented FDM in the late 80s, so that's why we went where we went with that technology. But you're right, the SLS gives a better surface finish. You don't get the layer lines as pronounced.
Anyone else?
Oh, yeah. Just a question related to the bio and the coral side. I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name.
Emmanuel.
So a very nice presentation, Emmanuel, so thank you for that. It looked like some of the core competence in your group was around the ability to scan, and that looked like it was really sophisticated. And then on the flip side, you were talking about kind of ultimakers, which were able to build up the corals, and they're not very sophisticated. So what way is the center of gravity in your group around being able to generate those 3D images and then the resolution that's there? I mean, you show quite good resolution. Where are you with the resolution of your imaging techniques?
So we're using different techniques. So with the kites, we have about 10 to 50 centimeters resolution because we are about 50 meters. But with a lighting microscope, we're down to 150 nanometers.
You're down to nanometers with kind of
with
photogrammetry.
We're down to 150 nanometers resolution. And what we try to do is to make sure we can embed any 3D into the next head. So we can scale up and down in 3D. In terms of the scanner itself, we have a very cheap scanner. Because, I mean, for example, this summer, Ben used a couple of rails, 3D printing, and get a scanner which is very efficient. In fact, 3D scanner technology looks really kind of expensive, but the optical principle is very, very easy and cheap to do. Most part of our microscope, even the one doing 150 nanometers, we could build it for $25,000.
Yeah. But you need the algorithms then that will do the photogrammetry work, or
it's already there. It's already open source. It's already shared between our communities. And what we are doing is things which have been developed in IMechE microscopy, which are quite advanced, actually works for the others. Because we know the guys, we are able to shift the algorithm to the next step. So
arguably, you can get very fine resolution on your imaging, but in the low-end printers, you don't really print that fine resolution, but the tools are okay because they're more or less teaching tools.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. It's very nice work.
Any other questions?
What is the crystalline structure like? You Noel, you mentioned it briefly there, but does it resemble, you know, let's say a extruded or forged element when it's sintered?
It's very unique, actually. It depends on the process parameters. It depends on how thin, for example, a particular strut would be. So if you do a section in an EBSD image of the crystalline microstructure of additive manufactured part, it the crystals and the grains are orientated in a particular path that's very clear in what way they were made. So basically, it looks... First time I saw an EBSD image of it, I kind of thought it looked like a melted candlestick. So the grains were orientated at approximately 45 degrees, kind of in this direction, and they were quite long and elongated at the time of build. But the second step in most additive manufactured parts, particularly in the DMLS production method, is to anneal the specimen. So that will recrystallize and lose that structure. So the area that I'm looking at the moment is... can we orientate, or can we model, and can we control the crystalline structure before you get to annealing to give you a mechanical advantage? And can you vary the mechanical properties over a part, for example? So one part of your implant might be optimized for compression, and one part for tension, and so on. So that's I probably should have thrown up an EBSD image, but the crystalline structure is very unique.
Sorry, just to follow on from that, I noticed that some of the turbine blades, the aircraft, or were they aircraft engine turbine blades?
Yes,
They were, and are these, is that similar in terms of its crystalline structure?
It's slightly different because in the EBM process, you're actually heating the whole of the part throughout the whole of the process. So you've got that control right from the base to the finished part. After sort of that particular, those particular parts were larger than the standard parts, so they were built on a very special machine that was just dedicated to build that one part. The whole thing was to control the structure throughout the build.
With regards to 3D scanning and putting that into printing, is there a fundamental block as to why you couldn't use 3D scanning and then some algorithm to use 3D printing as a repair tool? So say cratering wear on cutting tools, scan the tool, have something to compare to what it's meant to be and make a repair program. Is that a fundamental thing or just not developed?
Some of the hybrid machines are starting to sort of address that issue. Some of the milling and additive manufacturing, which are just repair features. In most of the additive manufacturing process, you need to have a flat surface to build on, so you're not building on a 3D surface.
Yeah, there's a few other different types of machines. I forget who mentioned it, but the laser tech, the Mari laser tech. So that would be kind of like a cladding process where we could take a part that's partially built and then add some material on and then come back and machine it. So those machines are still kind of in development and pretty new. So it's just the technology hasn't been kind of, the software to drive it hasn't been brought forward. But those companies like DMG Mari are pushing that quite a lot, especially for blades. But yeah, it's just something that would be developed a bit further. So the machines are there. Professor Byrne is...
Can I just ask Colin a second question? On the EBM, the comparator of EBMing used to the laser sintering, is there some good analysis work done on that comparison? I suppose I'm thinking, you mentioned technologically some advantages, but then also economically how it compares. So is there a comparison between the two technologies that would be useful, for example, as a study for us to have a look at?
Fathom the question. The answer out of that.
Well, I suppose the question really that I'm getting to is if somebody was investing in a system, yeah. You know, they want to see, first of all, the technological advantages and disadvantages of the different technologies, and they will also want to see the economic benefits or advantages or disadvantages. So I suppose it's a comparison in the technologies really that I'm interested in knowing about.
Well, yeah, I think hopefully from some of the slides I've shown anyway, is most companies, when they start investigating the technology, want to build test pieces and coupons and test material properties and strength and things like that. Hopefully that's been reasonably satisfied between laser and EBM to be on a par. But we're moving out of the prototyping stage into production, so the next stage is to how that is controlled and organised through being able to stack parts, being able to build parts that don't need heat treatment or wire erosion. These are the sort of production sort of aspects that most additive manufacturing companies have to face. There are a number of case studies and there are a number of reports out there, the difference between sort of laser and EBM. But with companies that are buying into the technology tend to have to use both systems if they want to satisfy all of the projects that are coming through.
Thank you.
I have a question just in front there. Yeah? Do you have a question? No, oh, sorry.
Just as regards the EBM technology, do you ever think it could get to a stage where it could get to maybe a desktop device, which could sound completely ridiculous, but in terms of the vacuum, is it difficult to maintain? Because if the speed is such a big issue, surely the vacuum has to be set up. So does the system have to be left running?
It's a very sensitive process, and the EBM aspect of it, just to get the gun calibrated correctly, is not something that you're going to have in the home. It's just too...
So do you leave the system constantly running then?
Pardon?
Do you leave the system consistently running, or would you turn it on and off?
You do turn it on and off, but you do go through calibration processes probably after each batch, just to make sure that if you look at some of the batches that you want to build, that could be building for 80, 100 hours maybe, you want to make sure it's calibrated at the start of each process. It's a check that you do, and then hopefully it has to normally be done. It's getting to a stage now where it used to be done by very specialist engineers. Now we're hopefully trying to pass this on to the customers to be able to do this themselves. So the calibration equipment is getting better.
Gareth has another question.
Yeah, so just related to that, I think it was actually really interesting the way we all had a little laugh after we said, well, maybe we won't have it at home. But, you know, if we said that 10 years ago when we were talking about the FDM machine, then probably people were having a little giggle then as well. And what do you see, if we watched that at €70,000 10 years ago for an FDM machine and it's €700 now for a hobby one, do you see it kind of a drive downwards on the price of your kit and generally additive in metals going down from the €500,000 and €700,000 mark down to some kind of floor? And do you see a rate of, the rate of which that might happen?
From an electron beam point of view, I don't see it that coming down that dramatically. From the lasers, I do.
Yeah.
But then you still have some even stronger battles that was mentioned earlier about that you're not going to get people at home just thinking they can press a button. You're going to have somebody that knows about CAD. They're going to know to orientation. And it was quite an interesting talk I heard from Graham Tromans a couple of years ago, and he said that would you take a 3D printed handle of a saucepan, fill it with boiling water, and hold it over your child's head and think that that's going to be okay because it's a 3D printed part? What I see is that people like Dyson and Hoover and all these sort of manufacturers, they're not going to put all of their IP onto the internet so you can download all of their parts and print them off. So it's going to come up with your way that you can interpret something and redesign it, and it's never going to be right. The equipment itself, is the price of that going to come down in metals? Who knows, but we're still working with, we're trying to work with pure metals to build parts that, some of the metals that we're talking about, the titanium and aluminium, highly reactive. You put aluminium through a normal vacuum cleaner to suck the powder up, and that vacuum cleaner would explode. So there's a lot of things that I don't think would actually come down into the home system unless there were some serious safety things that are also addressed.
Yeah, well, I think the home bit for sure not, but for an everyday company, could an everyday company, so Schivo at the top end of high performance in companies, but can you imagine that, an ordinary company, will be in it, will it ever be €100,000?
Well, there are smaller metals machines at the moment. They're around about €130,000, €140,000. So I think that price is coming down slightly.
Yeah.
But it's to do with the volume of machines. That's still a massive amount. That's still... I think that if you're only producing 80 to 100 machines a year, which a manufacturer could be, the automakers, they're sort of producing those every day. It's sort of it's all to do with the volumes.
I would give an example. For example, in IMechE microscopy, we are dealing with terabyte of data. And the only way we manage to solve that problem in 5 years is by having a very active open community. And this problem has been solved, and now the open source software is beating the crap of any kind of big companies within 5 years, because the dynamic of an open community worldwide now give us massive amounts of possibilities and design being worked for in different places. And I do believe, even though the home situation is probably not within the next 5 years, but I will not be surprised to get it coming in 10 years. When you see the dynamic of Instructable, for example, in Thingiverse, and the amount of design coming every month, and the improvement of a design done by a Chinese guy, then by an American guy, and they come out with solutions which are amazing within the fractions of a year. rather than before it was taking 5-10 years and we had to go through companies and it was not working. So I think this is going to be faster than before. The open source and the open community systems are really, really efficient to solve massive issues. For that, we still have a problem with the electron beam that we have to control, but I will not be surprised if it come out.
No, it's just the other thing as well, just to add to that, is in recent years, a lot of the patents have expired on a lot of the plastic systems, so you just get everybody then starting to design these new systems. In the metal side, a lot of the big companies have got key patents that are going to be tied up for the next 10, 15 years, so that will sort of restrict that. But plastics, you've seen a bit of an explosion from that aspect.
So yeah, we've got one more question, so and then we'll touch on.
Are there any concerns about IP protection? So what's to stop people from taking the new iPhone and scanning it and replicating it? How does the industry protect IP in terms of people selling machines to, you know, to make 3D parts?
There is a level of paranoia, I'd say, around that. I mean, you know, we've contracts with Stratasys that go to hundreds of pages, you know, telling us what we can and cannot print, what we can and cannot authorise people to print. Even if you raise a purchase order with the Stratasys direct manufacturer, the PO is one page and the terms and conditions are 3 pages. But the same applies to any other technology. I mean, if you go out there and you buy a CNC machine and you buy a decent PC with a good bit of CAD software, you could, in theory, make, well, not that, but you know what I mean, you could make something. So, like, it's, I worked in a company a couple of years ago, like life support ventilators, and when we updated the software, order one came from a competitor in China, and we sent it to them because they're just going to reverse engineer it anyway. And I'm not picking on the Chinese on this one, but that's what happens, you know. I suppose this technology just let it happen faster, maybe.
Okay, I think we want to finish up there. I think we're good on time, so I'm just going to give a quick. Yeah. So sorry.
Okay, just to close the event, just to introduce myself, I'm Paul Dillon. I'm the chair of the so-called senior committee of the IMechE in the Republic of Ireland. Shane is the chair of the actual young members committee. We have our next event, which is actually on the 3rd of November, it's going by there, which is on design, and we have a talker from the UK, Dr. David Ball, who is presenting work about the design challenge, which I thought was a very interesting theme throughout a lot of the talks that we had tonight, was this concept of how 3D printing or additive manufacturing has to change our way of thinking about how we make things or how we design things. And I think that's an important aspect that I got from the talks tonight. So our usual, I'm not going to go on and on, our usual vote of thanks is to give a very encouraging round of applause to our speakers. So I'd ask you to join in. There was a fantastic range of talks, applications, research going on, like especially shown here in Ireland. One of the aims of the group is to provide networking events, you know, to showcase what's going on with different groups and to bring people together to have good, great discussions. And I think Shane helped basically all that. So I think a round of applause for Shane and the young members.